Well, good morning. I am Pastor Briannis Mitchell, lead pastor, senior pastor of Mount Gilead Missionary Baptist Church in Nashville, Tennessee. One church, two locations, 901 Ackland Avenue and 4004 Lebanon Pike in the Hermitage area. Well, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we choose to rejoice and be glad in it. As I always say, to God be the glory for the things that He has done, for what He is doing, and for what He will do in our lives. Well, I know some of you all are still full or probably had a long night as you just celebrated 4th of July for those of us or you who have celebrated that. And so what a wonderful opportunity it is to worship together today in the privacy of your own home, on your phone, on your iPad, on your Android, on your Mac, on your Dell, whatever device you're using. What a privilege it is this morning to have the opportunity to share the Word of God with you and the ministry of Mount Gilead Missionary Baptist Church. Well, let me sort of give you a brief introduction today. I am beginning the series on prayer. It's taken from the book of Matthew chapter 6. It is in Luke as well. As the disciples asked Jesus, according to Luke, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples also to pray. You know, often we look at that passage of scripture in Matthew, you know, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And for years it has been called the Lord's Prayer, but it's not the Lord's Prayer. Actually, the Lord's Prayer is in John chapter 17. And that is when he prays, Father, make them one as you and I are one. What we have been given in Matthew chapter 6 and in Luke's account of it is a paradigm, is some principles. It's a mindset that we ought to have when we go to God in prayer. So get your Bibles, open them up to Matthew chapter 6. Our praise team is going to come and lead us in worship this morning. And then I'll be back to preach the Word of God. Let's go to worship right now.
You're alive and breathing.
It's a good day. It's a good day. It's not a bad day. Another day the Lord has made. Stop calling it a bad day. Such thing as a bad day.
Listen.
Cause every day you wake up.
Every day you wake up.
Every day you wake up.
Every morning you open your eyes.
Every day you wake up.
On the other side of the grave.
That's a good day.
Wherever you are.
Good morning, Mount Gilead. We would just like to welcome you into this place of worship, where we are excited about giving God our best. Come on and join in with us as we bless the name of the Lord on this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Wherever you are, just lift your hands and begin to exalt the name of the Lord. Forgetting about your problems and your troubles and just focusing on Him. Hallelujah, Jesus. You're worthy, God.
Our community show his ability. will of the Lord for his children is to demonstrate perpetual. Something's changing. See his glory. Feels like heaven on earth. Something's moving. Something's changing. See his glory. It's just like heaven on earth. Come on.
Something's moving.
Yeah.
Something's changing. See his glory.
I felt like they were really a good spiritual church. Reverend Carter was a spiritual man. Yeah.
And it was a family church.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. Right.
That's right.
Right. Which
I always went to church. I was one of the persons who couldn't hardly wait for Sunday to come because I loved to go to church. Mm-hmm.
What did you do at Mount Gilead?
Mary Dismuth Mission Circle.
Mary Dismuth Missionary Circle, yeah. And what did you all do in the missionary circle?
We used to visit homes and, you know, do things for people if they were sick. We have song and prayer. We used to pass out to the people for Christmas. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I did work a little in the Vacation Bible School. Yeah, Breonna Mitchell.
You had Breonna and his twin brother, Cleonis.
Yeah.
When you worked in the school system.
Oh, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Mm. You sang in choir number 2?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, and you recall some of the other people who were in choir number 2 with you?
Yeah, Mabel Espy.
Miss Sal, Orly Sal.
Yeah, that's right.
Miss Dysart, Lucy Dysart. Evelyn Clay Brooks.
That's right.
How about Margaret Hunter?
Yeah, all of them was in the choir.
Okay, and how long did you sing in the choir?
Ooh, I reckon about 2 years or more. Marching to Zion. That was the one we marched in on a lot.
Remember those words?
We marching to Zion, a beautiful, beautiful Zion. We marching on up to Zion, a beautiful city of God. Come ye that love the Lord, and let your voice be known. Join in the song of freedom accord. Let your voice be known. We're marching to Zion, a beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, that beautiful city of God.
Wow, have we not been blessed? Every week I just stand amazed at the music ministry of Mount Gilead. They do such an incredible job week after week, and it's just a blessing to have individuals and some good singers to lead us in worship each week. Hey, before we receive your offering, let me say, if you enjoy what we're giving you, will you like this, share it, and all that kind of stuff so that other people can see what's going on in the life of Mount Gilead and see and enjoy worship as you've been enjoying worship yourself. And before we give, let me say one more thing. What about Miss Michelle? Miss Michelle, believe it or not, she was my fifth and sixth grade teacher. And isn't that crazy that now at the age of 47, I am Mrs. Michelle's pastor? God has a weird way of making everything come full circle. Every week we've been celebrating and honoring members of our church who are 90 plus, and we're blessed to have so many who God has allowed their golden years to roll on just a little while longer. Well, let's prepare to give our gifts to God, our offerings to God. 10% of what God has given to you is how we give in the Christian faith. That means if you made $100, it's 10. If you made 500, it's 50. Your gifts to God help us to continue to do what we're doing and to make sure that we are doing our part in allowing God's kingdom to come on earth as it is in heaven. So whichever way you choose to give, you can give by Givelify. That information is on there. You see the brown-looking building, which is our South Campus. You can give that way, or you can text to give. And that information is on the screen right now, and you have the opportunity to give that way. Or if you're like our older and senior members who don't trust all that technology, you can mail your gifts from wherever you are in the country to us. You can mail it to 4004 Leveland Pike, Hermitage, Tennessee, 37076. Let me pray for you, and then let's prepare to hear the word of the Lord. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to give. We don't give to be blessed. We give because we're already blessed. You've been faithful to us. You've been good to us. How can we repay you for all the things you have done for us? So, Lord, take these gifts that we're going to give and allow us as a church to use it for your glory. But for those who give, come no shorter than your word. Open the windows of heaven and pour them out a blessing that they will not have room enough to receive it. Thank you. As we always pray and sing our chant as a church, all things come from you and is of your own that we give back to you. Bless now both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Real quick, get your gifts together. Here's what's going on in Mount Gilead.
Great morning, Mount Gilead. Let's take a look at the exciting things that we have coming up. Summer's here, and it's time for us to kick back, refresh, and regroup. Join us back in August for our action-filled Bible studies. Do you have some free time? Would you like to volunteer at Mount Gilead? We are looking for volunteers for the office and for our media department. If you would like to volunteer, please send your name, number, availability, and whether you would like to volunteer for office or media to info@mgileadchurch.org. We want to make sure that we are connecting with you. Stay in the know by updating your information. You can stay connected with us by scanning the QR code on your screen with your phone or by going to the website at www.mgileadchurch.org to fill out the member information form. Stay connected with us. For more information on all that we have going on at Mount Gilead, contact us at connect@mgileadchurch.org. Visit us online at www.mgileadchurch.org or find us on social media at Mgilead Nashville on Facebook and Instagram. We would love to stay connected with you. We are extremely excited about all the great things that we have going on here at Mount Gilead, and we can't wait to see you involved.
Well, by now, I hope you've turned your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, and I want to lift up for this sermon verses 5 through 8. Whenever you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by people. Truly, I tell you, they have their reward. But when you pray, go into your private room, shut your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, don't babble like the Gentiles, since they imagine they'll be heard for their many words. Don't be like them, because your Father knows the things you need before you ask him. Lord, open our hearts and our minds and our ears to hear what you have to say to us this morning. Do as you have done on other occasions. Separate that which is of the flesh from that which is of the spirit. And as we impart words of information and inspiration, my prayer is that your people would be both receptive and responsive to the preaching of the gospel. Pour in me and through me and out of me the gift of expository preaching, so that men and women might know the continuation of your redemption and your steadfast love for us. Lord, those things that I have prepared and printed in private, I pray now that you would bring them back to my remembrance in public. Forgive me of my sins. Thank you for the gift of salvation by grace through faith. It is a gift from you, not from my own works, lest I should brag or boast. So Lord, take full control of my heart, mind, and body, and use it for your own glorification. Those things I've counted gain unto myself, I count now loss unto thee. And I ask it all in the strong name of Jesus. And God's people said together, amen. I want to talk about the private place for prayer. There are two disciplines that are essential to our Christian maturity. One is a life of study. The Bible teaches us that we are to study to show ourselves approved. A workman needed not be ashamed, rightly divides the word of truth. But the second discipline that is essential to your Christian maturity is not a life of study, but it is a life of prayer. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. In Luke chapter 17, we are told by Jesus that he likens the last days to the days of Noah. And then in Luke chapter 18, verse 1, he opens that passage of scripture by saying these words: that men ought to always pray and not faint. What Jesus is saying to us is that in the times of trouble and trials, sickness and suffering, racism and COVID-19, Jesus reminds us that fainting people don't pray, but praying people don't faint. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. He says in Luke 18 and 1 that men ought to always pray and not faint. When we watch the life and living of Jesus, we are struck by the priority and prominence he gave to prayer. Jesus was a man of prayer, and that same trait, that same characteristic, he desires to be seen in the life of you and myself as well. We are told over and over again in Scripture that we ought to be people that pray. 1 Thessalonians, we're reminded that we ought to pray without ceasing. In Matthew chapter 5, we are told to pray for them that despitefully use us. In Matthew chapter 6, again, we are reminded that we ought to pray again. Over and over again in Scripture, we are reminded of the priority and the prominence that we ought to give to prayer. So let me ask you this morning, where is prayer on your list of things you have to do on an everyday basis? Are you that individual that just prays when the lights get turned off? Are you that individual that only prays when there's a doctor appointment coming up? Jesus says that men ought to always pray and not faint. Jesus was a man of prayer. And that same trait and priority he wants to see in the life of you and myself. We ought to be people of prayer. So what does it mean to pray? Prayer is never the articulation of the mouth, but prayer is the attitude of your heart. Prayer is not the words that you say. For when we read Scripture, what prayer really is, prayer is worship. Prayer is communication. It is a conversation to God and is also an opportunity to have God respond back to you. Such is the case that we are presented with in Matthew chapter 6, verses 5, and all the way to verses 14. Here, according to Luke, the disciples have come to Jesus and have asked him this question. Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught also his disciples to pray. The model prayer is not, this prayer is not the Lord's prayer. For the Lord's prayer would be the prayer that Jesus himself prayed, and that prayer is given to us in Scripture in John chapter 17. But what we have been given in Matthew chapter 6 is a paradigm, is a mindset that you and I ought to have whenever we go to God in prayer. They asked Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples also to pray. If you could ask the Lord to teach you anything, what would you ask him to give you instruction on? Of all the things that they could have asked for, Lord, teach us to heal the sick as you heal the sick. Lord, teach us to cast out demons as you cast out demons. Lord, give us the power to raise the dead as you have raised the dead. But no, their question was, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught also his disciples to pray. What they saw something in the life and living of the Lord Jesus Christ that they recognized was something they would need for the rest of their journey. And here in Matthew chapter 6, he provides for us a mindset that you and I ought to have whenever we go to God in prayer. He says here that when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by people. Truly, I tell you, they have their reward. But when you pray, go into your private room, shut your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you in open. There are three things that these verses want to say to you and I today, and let me share them with you. In the first place, these verses say something to us about a poor posture for prayer. When you pray, don't pray like the hypocrites, for they love to be seen by their prayers.
Jesus says that they have their reward already. What he's saying is interesting here. Is Jesus suggesting from this that corporate prayer, that congregational praying is something that we ought not engage in? Absolutely not. What the text is suggesting is that when we pray, we're not praying to be seen by men. That God does not reward us from the words that we say. That God does not reward us based on the applause of people. You know, we hear that all the time. They showing up praying. What is showing up praying? We hear people say all the time, that's a good prayer. But even in our worship, especially in an African-American culture, we need to understand that prayer is not something we brag about. That prayer is not something that we push other people to do. That prayer is conversation with God. It's not a matter of the articulation. It's the attitude of your heart. And if prayer is the articulation of your heart, is what's been said in your heart and not what's been said with your mouth, then we need to understand that there's a bad way to pray. And Jesus says, whenever you pray, if you're praying to be rewarded, if you're praying to be high-fived, if you're praying for people to say that was a good prayer, he said that's a poor way to pray. Why? Because he says that's all you're seeking. See, it's a matter of the heart. And if all you're looking is for people to say something about your praying and not see the results, then Jesus says to them, you already have your reward before you. There's a poor picture of praying in this text. And a poor picture of praying is when we pray to be seen of men, when we pray for people to say that was a good prayer, when we pray for people to applaud us. We don't pray to be applauded. We don't pray for people to reward us publicly. We pray because God hears and answers prayers. Well, there's a second thing this text wants to say to us this morning. In the first place, there's a word about a poor picture of praying. But in the second place, there's a word about a private place to pray. But when you pray, go into your secret room or your secret closet, and your Father who sees you in secret will reward you in open. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. Again, Jesus is not suggesting, amen, that congregational or corporate prayer, amen, should be prohibited or avoided. What he is suggesting is an attitude of the heart. He's talking about the mindset. He is talking about the circumstances that cause us to pray. He says to them, and when you pray in your secret room, that word there in the Greek language is tabion. It's talking about an oriental room on the ground floor. It was used for storage. It was a place that nobody else wanted to go. It was a vacant place. It wasn't the living room. It wasn't on the front. It wasn't a room where everybody else went in the house. He says, and when you pray, go into your tabion. Go into a place that nobody else wants to go, but go into a place where you won't be bothered. Go into your private place of praying. I'm saying to somebody here this morning, all of us ought to have a private place where we can go to God in prayer. He says that when you go to that, go to your private place of praying. But when you go to your private place of praying, watch what he says. There's something you have to practice. You got to shut the door. Go into your secret room and shut the door. What is he suggesting when he says shut the door? He is saying, get to a place in God. Get to a silent and a secret, a solemn. Get to a place where you won't be interrupted, and there tune the world out. That's what happens. That's why I get up early in the morning and open my Bible and read it and go through my morning devotion, because I need a time and a place to pray. Hey, where Brendan's not interrupting me, where the TV's not interrupting me, where email is not interrupting me, where social media is not interrupting me. And this is what I want to tell you. If you want a powerful prayer life, then you got to have a place where you can go, where you can shut everything out. Shut all the noise out. Shut all the situations out. Shut all the frustrations out. Shut every circumstance out so that you can talk to God in prayer. Well, he says in this text, there's a poor picture of praying. He says there is a private place that you and I ought to have to go pray. But there's a third thing he says in this text. He says there's a public promise from our prayer life. When you go into your room, shut the door. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you in the open. This text didn't make a whole lot of sense to me, but it does now as I've gotten older. Listen to what Jesus says to you and I. He is saying that there are situations and circumstances that push us to our private place. Somebody listened to me this morning. You got pushed to your private place of prayer because of a cancer diagnosis. For somebody else, it's the death and dying of a loved one. For somebody else, it's wondering how you're going to pay your bills. For somebody else, it's relationship problems and how's the marriage going to work. For somebody else, it's a wayward child who's in some jail cell. For somebody else, it's just trying to get peace in your mind. Here's what Jesus is saying. Whatever pushes you to your private place, God bless his holy name. He says the issue is shut the door. Amen. Because they don't have control on what God will do in your secret place. What I'm trying to tell you is there are some situations and there are some people that have pushed you to a private place, but they don't know how you're going to look when you come out of this situation. I want to rise and tell somebody, hey man, whatever is driving you to your private place, whatever you're going through that's taking you to your private place, your Father that sees you in secret will reward you in open. Life has its share of individuals and circumstances and situations and crises and sicknesses and just the ills of life that push us to a private place. But the good news this morning is that when it pushes us to a private place, our Father who sees us in a secret, in a private, in a tameon, in a storage room, will reward us in the open. Amen, amen, amen. I've tried to figure out how to close this passage and how to make sense of your Father seeing you in secret will reward you in open. And it didn't make sense to me until I went back and thought about growing up as a young man. When I was growing up, y'all, they used to have telephone booths. We didn't have cell phones. We didn't have Verizon. We didn't have T-Mobile. We didn't have Cricket. We didn't have Sprint. Everybody kept a quarter, amen, on them at all times. And you could go to a telephone booth and you could put your quarter in and then use the phone. But here's the part I like about it is that when you went to the phone booth back in the day, I know some of y'all too young to know what I'm talking about, but back in the day when you went to a phone booth, when you would go in the phone booth, what happened is when you shut the door, the light would come on. Some of y'all missed that one. Yeah. Whatever pushed you to the phone booth because you needed to make that call, the good news was that when you shut the door, the light comes on. Good night. May the Lord bless you real good. But that's what I want to say to somebody here today. Go in your private room and shut the door. And when you shut the door, the light comes on. The light comes on how he'll take care of your kids. The light comes on how he'll pay your bills. The light comes on how he's a doctor in the sick room. The light comes on how he'll bring us back together. The light comes on how there's a cure for COVID. The light comes on how your marriage will work. The light comes on how he can heal cancer. The light comes on how he can make ways out of no way. Go into your private room and shut the door. Good night. Let me ask you, and I'm done this morning. Is it anybody here that's ever been in your private place? But in your private place, the light came on. I'm here right now. Praise his holy name, because God rewards us openly. And that's a good close. I'm not going to hoop it, but that's a good close for somebody here this morning, is that you've got some stuff that people see public, but they don't know what you went through in private. Hey, man, if we was in church and it wasn't COVID, I'd tell you high-five your neighbor and touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor. But since we not, let me just tell you, is it anybody in here that's listening to me this morning that know you've got some stuff that you can praise God in public? Because you had to pray to God in private. Good. May the Lord bless you real good. Our Father who sees us in secret will reward you openly. You know, people don't get that most of the stuff we got, it happened through prayer. Something happens when you and I learn to pray together. There's a poor picture for praying. Don't try to be seen of people. There's a private place to pray. All of us ought to have a room where we can go and shut everything out and just talk to God. But then there's a public promise God makes to us. Whatever has pushed you in public, in private, God will reward you in public. You ain't got to fight the battle in public. You ain't got to try to figure it out in public. Just go to your private place. And the God that we serve hears and answers prayers. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. I don't know who you are listening to this message or watching us week after week if we've had the virtual stream. I don't know if you're the family in Virginia who continues to sow into this ministry. I don't know if you're the group in Texas or wherever you are in this world that's listening to us. Here's what I want you to know. Prayer still works. I'll never forget, I was at Watson Grove, my home church. We were up in the balcony, me and Pastor Goodwin. It was right the week we was in association meetings, and right before the week before he would go in for surgery and surprisingly make his transition. We were sitting in the balcony, and the choir was singing. A lady by the name of Michelle Vaughn was singing a song by Vanessa Bell Armstrong. Vamp of it is prayer still works. And I'll never forget, he looked at me and he said, "Doctor, prayer still works." That rings in my ear. Every time I hear that song, I think about my late pastor. But I want you to know today, prayer still works. And I'm here to pray with you. I'm here to pray with you. There's information on the screen how you can get connected. Put it in the chat. Send us a message to inbox us. We want to pray with you. We want you to know that we're here to help you get through what you're going through. No, Jesus is not teaching the absence of public prayer. We need prayer. But what he's saying is prayer is never the articulation of the lips. It's the attitude of the heart. So I'm praying for you. If you don't know Jesus and the pardon of your sin, I want you to get to know him. You can do that right now. Something is driving you into a private place. But there in that private place, the Lord our God will bring you out much better than you were when you went in. Repeat after me if you haven't received the Lord Jesus Christ. Dear God, I confess I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I accept Jesus Christ. I believe that he died and rose for my sins. And I confess him now, Lord of Lords and King of Kings. If you prayed that prayer, you're in and not out. You're part of the family, you're not out. Will you get some information to us? That information's on your screen. Will you get that to us as to how we can better serve you and help you know Christ in a very real and personal way? It's been a blessing sharing the word of God with you today. It's been a privilege every week after week, even though I'm in a gym preaching with one guy holding the cameras and one guy on a keyboard. Still, I believe that what God has given to me here is rewarding and making a difference in your life there. So keep praying. Whatever you do, don't stop praying, because prayer still works. I'll see you till we have the time to see each other again next Sunday at the same time. Remember, life is always best lived as a journey forward. Well, we're out of time. I'm not out of text. I'm certainly not out of preaching. But thank you for taking the opportunity
to view Mount Gilead Missionary Baptist Church on whatever social media platform you chose to do today. We are made the richer and the better, and we thank God for the opportunity to come into your life and to share the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'd love to hear from you. You can email me at pastor, P-A-S-T-O-R, at mgileadchurch.org. I'd love to hear from you. I'd love to pray with you. And if you'll send me an email, I'll be blessed to have the opportunity to reach back to you. You know, life is best lived in community. And we make a commitment in this church to serve in community, which means we want to be engaged with you and we want to really be a part of your life. So again, thank you for viewing this broadcast. I look forward to seeing you on the next stream or the next worship service or any opportunity Mount Gilead gives you to be a part of our worship. I always say life is always best lived as a journey forward. Go serve somebody this week.
Somebody's dealing with depression. Somebody's having trouble finding a job. But you gotta keep pressing on.